We'll quickly see the couple of sentences which we read last time and then proceed further. Absolute they dwell, unborn, immutable, immaculate in the spirit's deathless air, immaculate in the spirit's deathless air, immortal in a world of motionless time, and an unchanging views of deep self-space. Absolute they dwell, they refers to the previous sentence, the eternal marvels bliss, no? The eternal marvels, they, the eternal marvels. Where do they dwell? Absolute they dwell, unborn, immutable, immaculate in this spirit's deathless air, immortal in a world of motionless time, and an unchanging views of deep self-space. Unchanging views of deep self-space. Before that we have got immortal in a world. Well, that can be understood. Immortal in a world, we can understand without any problem. But world of motionless time, that is a mystery. Motionless time. We never have an idea, a concept of time not moving. Time is still. Time is an arrow which keeps on moving, moving, moving all the while, you see. But the arrow is not moving here at all. And yet, there is some kind of dynamism in the entire process. That is what time is. Time is the subjective dynamism of action which is still. That is what the motionless time we could perhaps interpret, you see. It is the dynamism which is absolute, still calm. It is still there. I mean, it is there, but it is not moving. It is there means it is working there. After all, the concept of time is the subjective dynamism in the process of things. So, when you talk of the subjective dynamism, it can be still also, you see. So, this is a very new phrase, absolutely coming for the first time, that there is something like motionless time. I don't think we have anywhere in the philosophy, ancient or modern or anywhere, the idea, the concept of motionless time. I don't think it is there present even in life divine. The concept of motionless time is perhaps not present even in the life divine. It is for the first time that Savitri is revealing us, Sri Aurobindo's epic, Savitri is revealing us that there is something like a motionless time, you see. And an unchanging muse of deep self-space. Well, that we can understand. Space, unchanging, steady, muse, contemplating, meditating in that manner. That we can understand. But motionless time is a very, very wonderful kind of a phrase, you see. And perhaps one should really write long thesis on this, what motionless time is, a PhD problem, you see, for the students of philosophy. So this marvelous bliss, in that manner here, the eternal marvels. Only when we have climbed above ourselves, the marvels are there, we don't have those marvels here. But we can kind of come in contact with these marvels when we have climbed above ourselves. Above ourselves means what? Well, of course, the physical is there, the vital is there, the mental is there, even the spiritual is there. So even when you go beyond the spiritual, what we would call Atman, the cosmic self, when you go beyond the cosmic self, see the physical, mental rather physical, vital, mental, they are definitely belonging to the domain of ignorance. The spiritual, the illumined mind, the higher mind, the illumined mind, the intuition, even our mind, they are the spiritual planes. They are the spiritual planes. And when we go beyond, well, there, ignorance is there, but ignorance is much, much less. You see, ignorance is there, but it is much, much less. Only when you cross the overmind border, then you are really in the domain of knowledge. So when you are, only when we have climbed above ourselves, so all these ranges, when you go beyond that, then something may happen. So that is a kind of an obligation on us, that we have to climb above ourselves, go beyond even the spiritual experiences, realizations we can have. Only when we have climbed above ourselves, a line of the transcendent meets our road, the Gnostic and the overmind, they come and then join together at that point of time, you see, and joins us to the timeless and the true. That is beyond the overmind, you see, timeless and the true. It is not always true in the world of overmind. Overmind is a world of multiplicity. It is a world of knowledge of multiplicity without the knowledge of unity. Overmind is a world of knowledge of multiplicity without the knowledge of unity. That is overmind. So that is also a part of ignorance. Because you have the multiplicity, you have got variety of gods and religions and followers and all that thing. See, each one is a unit by itself, but the joining together of this, the unity of this, that is not available in the overmind world. We are under the domain of overmind, even at that highest level. In fact, the plethora of religions, the plethora of gods and all that, you got Shiva, you have got Vishnu, you have got Brahma, you got Jesus, you have got many, many kind of gods. They all belong to the overmental plane. See, they don't know each other, they don't really see each other also in a certain sense, that what is the unity behind them. Shiva does not see the aspect of the transcendental Vishnu which is present in Vishnu. Same way Vishnu does not see the transcendental aspect of Shiva which is present in Shiva, etc. like that, you see. The knowledge of multiplicity without the knowledge of unity, that is the character of overmind. So when we climb above ourselves, so we have to go really beyond that. Then only the transcendent meets our road, you see. Then the real beginning, you see. And joins us to the timeless and the true. It brings to us the inevitable world. At that point, the mantra arises. The power of expression comes into play here at that time. A godlike act. The thoughts that never die. The thoughts that never die. The thoughts are immortal. The thoughts are immortal. You see, thoughts are immortal. Godlike act, yes, in this Sachidananda world. Now, thoughts that never die. We have seen long ago in the Yoga of Savitri that she was asked to annul herself, that only God be, that only God be. She has to be completely empty of this inconscient stuff which is present in her. Emptied out inconscient, that is nirvana. Emptying out inconscience which is present in us, that is the true nirvana. You are really making now the whole place ready for only the truth to dwell. But if the inconscience is present, then the truth cannot really dwell fully, you see, in that sense. So she was asked to empty herself out completely, that only God be, you see. Now, one of the things she has to do was to see the origin of thought, where from they come. And she sees that the thoughts can come from our subtle realms, from the subtle body, the physical body which The gross physical is not there. Behind the gross physical, the subtle body, sukshma sharira, sukshma deha, which is there, the thoughts can arise from that, from the brain, from the limbs, from the heart, from legs, from feet, from everywhere, from the very cell, the thoughts can arise. She sees that in the subtle world, the thoughts can arise from that thing. She also sees that the thoughts can come straight from the cosmic space. They either arise from the subtle body within us, or they come from the cosmic space outside. Actually, you can see that, I will give the reference, we will read that thing also. So she beheld the many births of thought, many births of thought. Births of thought in various places. Thought in the world of Ananda, thought in the world of consciousness, thought in the world of Sat, thought in the world of mind, thought in the physical thought, many births of thought. So she beheld the many births of thought. If births can be of what eternal is, these thoughts are eternal. He says here, same thing, no, here, thoughts that never die. Thoughts that never die. So she beheld the many births of thought. If births can be of what eternal is. So that is the quality of the thought, real thought, genuine thought is him. For the eternal's powers are like himself. Thoughts that never die, they are the part of the eternal. Timeless in the timeless, in time ever born. That is what the eternal also does. That when he steps into time, he is ever born, constantly renews himself, so to say. This too she saw, that all in our outer mind is made, not born. All in our outer mind is made, not born. See, what we think, our thoughts, they are made by mind, outer mind, surface mind. They are not really the product of the eternal, surface mind. Our thoughts, our thinking, our ideas, our conceptions, they are part of the surface mind, superficial mind, you see. Therefore, they are perishable. They come and they disappear. Therefore, they are perishable. Because they are part of the surface mind, they are perishable, you see. So, whatever is a part of this world is in a sense perishable. Whereas the eternal, thought that never die, they belong to the eternal.